Good morning, everyone, and I hope you're having a wonderful Memorial Day weekend. So I guess most of you don't go to school or don't go to work and have one more day of rest. It's always good to have a long weekend. So we think about the meaning of Memorial Day. I guess we should be thankful for the sacrifices of those who shed their blood for protecting this country and for the good cause. Over Zoom, if you can see me, if you can hear me okay, can you wave your hand for me? Can you see me? Can you hear me okay? Thank you. So last Sunday, we talked about Moses sending 12 spies to the Promised Land to make sure it's possible to enter the Promised Land. There were 12 spies, but how many of them had positive faith and said it was God's will, God's power, it's okay to enter because it's going to be victorious in God's power? Out of 12 spies, how many had that positive faith? Was it one of the 12? Was it two of the 12? Was it three of the 12? Or was it four? Once again, we're talking about Moses sending spies into the Promised Land before they engage into the battle. 12 spies came back, and only how many of them gave positive report upon positive faith? Was it one or two? Or three, or four, and it was only two. Two out of 12. So two people had positive faith, the other 10 had negative faith. And only two who had positive faith were able to enter the Promised Land. Do you guys remember the names of those two, by the way? Joshua and Caleb, right? Joshua and Caleb were the only ones who had positive faith, and they were the only ones who were able to enter the Promised Land. All the others, including those negative faith 10 spies, had to die in that desert. Okay, we're going to sing our song of praise, and our key word today is bless. Every time you hear the word bless in our song, let us raise our left hand to glorify God.
I want to bless you, Lord, in all that I do. Let my life bring glory to you. Fill my heart so that love can flow. See, Lord, wherever bless you, Lord, in all that I do. Let my words bring glory to you. Guard my thoughts so that they might be filled with love and praises to thee. Bless you, Lord, in all that I do. Let my hands bring glory to you. Reaching out to the ones in need. Touch me, Lord, so you can use me. Use me, Lord, wherever I am.
miracles now and then, because there's some things that we cannot handle on our own. Some situations, no matter how smart we are, no matter how much money we have, there are some situations that we just can't handle on our own. That's when we have to kneel down before God and ask for His miracle. But as we're going to talk about today, miracle is not just automatic. It requires certain formula of faith. Now my question is, as we take this time to meditate and pray, do you believe in miracles? Do you want to have miracles in your life? Think about that. Let's take a moment to pray.
Into wine. This is Jesus,
Heyo!
Who is the Son of God and the Savior of the world. Jesus was born in Bethlehem and grew up in Nazareth, where he grew in wisdom and favor with God and man. One day, Jesus, his disciples, and his mother went to a wedding in Cana. In the middle of the party, the wine ran out.
Uh-oh.
So Jesus' mother, Mary, told him, "They have no more wine."
Aww.
Jesus replied, "Dear woman, that's not our problem. My time has not yet come." But Mary told the servants, "Do whatever he tells you." Standing nearby were 6 stone water jars. The Jews used jars like these in their washing ceremony. Jesus told the servants, "Fill the jars with water."
Hey, okay.
When the jars had been filled, he said, "Now dip some out and take it to the master of ceremonies." So the servants did what Jesus told them to. When the master of ceremonies tasted the water that was now wine, not knowing where it had come from, though of course the servants knew, he called the bridegroom over. A host always serves the best wine first. Then, when everyone has had a lot to drink, he brings out the less expensive wine. But you have kept the best until now. This miraculous sign in Cana in Galilee was the first time Jesus revealed his glory, and his disciples believed in him.
So this was the first miracle Jesus performed throughout his ministry of 3.5 years. Jesus performed many miracles, healing the sick, raising the dead. I mean, there were just countless stories of miracles Jesus performed. But this was the first and most fundamental, because it reveals almost like the secret or formula, if you will, of the miracle of faith. miracle of faith. Let's get into the story. So Jesus was at a wedding. Jesus' mother Mary was there, and Jesus' disciples also were there. So we're talking about the setting of wedding, and we're talking about the problem of wine running out. Those two things are really important, not only symbolically, but if you think about it, wedding is really a big event in someone's life. And wedding symbolizes husband and wife to become as one and starting a new family. And that's wedding. Festive, meaningful, just wonderful time of life. And the Bible talks about our relationship with Jesus. And in many verses, it is explained as Jesus is the husband. We, the church, we, the believers, we, Christians, are the wives. So it is no coincidence that Jesus performed this first miracle at a setting of wedding. It tells us an important message about Jesus is our husband. We are the church, the wives of Jesus, spiritually, of course. So our relationship, our setting, our lives must be something of a wedding. Every time there's wedding, back in the old days, of course, there's got to be wine. From the beginning until the end, the last guest leaves the banquet room, there has to be enough wine. I don't know exactly what happened, for the Bible doesn't explain it to us. Maybe there were just too many guests. Maybe they didn't have enough bottles, jars of wine. The wine ran out. And the story of miracle begins from that, within that setting. There were no more wine. Who told them? Jesus' mother, Mary. And it's kind of interesting that Mother Mary was the one who told Jesus. This was a serious big problem, and no one knew what to do about it except Mary. Of course, Mary knew that Jesus is the Son of God. Because from the birth, angel told Mary, "You will have a child. His name will be Jesus Christ. And he's not going to be an ordinary boy. He will be the Messiah, Christ." So Mary knew that all along. So as soon as Jesus began his ministry at the age of 30, Mary knew that something miraculous will happen. And she thought this was the moment. Okay, so my son, my biological son, the spiritual son of God, Jesus is going to make things happen now. He will begin his public ministry. So when wine was gone, Mary had this faith, Jesus will do something about it. And this will mark the beginning of his public ministry. There's no more wine. And his mother also told the servants, do whatever he tells you. Okay, we talked about obedience a lot in our sermon, especially when we talked about Abraham and Moses and David. You know, we talked about obedience. And let me give you some simple and direct definition of the word obedience in the Bible. What is the meaning of the biblical obedience? This is it. Do whatever he tells you. That is the meaning of the word obedience in the Bible. Do whatever the Bible tells you. Do whatever the Bible tells you. As simple as it is, it's so hard to obey. It's so hard to follow. I mean, you know the Bible, right? We've been studying the Bible for 10, 20, 30 years. From the Old Testament, the Ten Commandments, and Jesus' teaching. And the Bible is full of commandments, rules. It is telling us so many things that are so hard to keep up. It's about loving God. It's about serving our neighbors. It's about making sacrifices. And to obey means to do all that. Whatever the Bible tells us, we follow, we do. And then miracle happens. A lot of people believe in miracles. Many people pray for miracles, but not too many miracles are happening. Why? Because we don't do whatever the Bible tells us. We pray, we say we believe, but we don't do whatever the Bible tells us. So miracle is not happening. Miracle is not happening because we are not fulfilling this formula of faith. Do whatever Jesus tells you. Do whatever God tells you. Do whatever the Bible tells you. We know it. We know we're supposed to do that. We believe it too. It's just that we don't do it. Not whatever. Not everything. Not 100% of the teaching of the Bible. You know, people today, Christians today, are so smart. They pick and choose. They pick and choose from the Bible. All right, I'm going to live as a Christian, but then I'm not going to be fully committed. I'm not going to be 100% obedient. Let me draw the line on my own. Maybe 50%. Maybe 75% at best. Yeah, but that's what we do. We don't fully commit 100%. We don't fully obey 100%. We draw our own lines at 50, 60, 70, 80%. But that's not what the Bible is telling us about the definition of obedience. It's not we're doing whatever and everything the Bible tells us. As soon as we pick and choose, we are compromising our faith. Miracle will not happen. Nearby stood 6 stone water jars, kind used by the Jews for ceremonial washing, each holding from 20 to 30 gallons. You see how big these are. You know those, one of those sparklets water jars, right? Those are usually 5 gallons. But we're talking about the 6 stone jars, each containing like 20 to 30 gallons. That's a lot of water. It's a lot of water. And if you really think about how they draw the water, these servants, they probably had to go to a well or nearby river by foot. They probably have some containers on their shoulders, so back and forth. They went to draw like 150 gallons of water. 150 gallons of water. It took a lot of time. It took a lot of efforts. It took a lot of sweat. Until they fill it up to the jar, to the brim. And then only then, miracle is ready to happen. You know why miracle doesn't happen in a lot of people's lives? Because they quit trying. They quit believing. They look at it and ask, okay, I'm going to pray for about a couple of days and see what happens. No, it's not going to happen. It takes 150 gallons of water. It takes that much of faith and trying. And effort and sweat and endurance and all the sacrifice. And after all that, And only then it is said to have the miracle in that situation. Jesus said to the servants, fill the jars with water. So they filled them to the brim. If there were some smarty servants, they were probably thinking, water is water. We don't know what's going to happen. You know, how can we trust a stranger telling us to put water in these jars? Because it's not water we need. The banquet room is run out of wine. We need wine, but this strange guy is telling us to get some water and pull it into these huge jars. Oh, because this woman, this respected mother of Jesus, is telling us to do what he tells us to do. I guess we'll do it, but let me just do like halfway and see what happens. If there were some smarty servants, they're not going to fill it to the brim. They might fill it like halfway or two-thirds of the way. And if nothing happens, they will just throw it up. Give it up. See? Nothing happens. Nothing happens. We're going to stop here. We're not going to do it anymore. That's what a lot of people are doing about faith these days. They don't fill it to the brim. They don't complete it. They try some worship, they try some Bible studies, they try some prayers, but after a certain percentage of their own, they stop, they give up. It's not fulfilled, it's not completed. But to have miracle in our faith, Jesus makes it clear, fill it to the brim. Doesn't matter how long it takes. Doesn't matter how much effort you have to sacrifice. Fill it to the brim. So that is the key element of the miracle of faith. We have to fill it all the way. All the way to the brim. Now let this challenge us today. Is my faith all fulfilled? Am I really giving my 100% effort into believing in God and following the teachings of the Bible? Am I really doing it 100% all the way up to the brim? Or am I making my own calculation of compromise, stopping at 50%, 75%, which is not going to be enough? Here is the ultimate challenge. Jesus told the servants, now draw some out and take it to the master of the banquet. This is the ultimate test. We're talking about dirty water here. Okay, it's not purified water. You know, they didn't have all this great, wonderful, clean water system. They probably drew it from some well or some river, some stream outside in a hurry. So servants know that this is not perhaps drinkable water. And Jesus is telling them, draw it and give it to the master of the banquet. So the servants had to make a choice in this instance. Okay, if I obey and take this water to the master of the banquet, and he's going to punish me. He's going to beat me up. Because I'm bringing this dirty water for our guests when what is needed is some wine. As servants know, because they draw it from the well or the river, this is not wine, this is just dirty water. If I obey, I need to take the risk of getting beaten up. But the servants obeyed. The key word, key phrase in that verse is the simple phrase, sentence there, where it says, they did so. They did it. They obeyed it. They took some water out of the jar and they brought it to the banquet, to the master. This is the action of faith of Mary. Not only we understand the Bible, not only we believe in the Bible, we actually have to do it. We actually have to do it, and then miracle happens. A lot of Christians today, for a lot of us, we say we believe, but it stops there. We don't do anything that we're supposed to do. We don't take risk. We want to be politically correct. We want to be economically safe. We don't take that risk. But unless we take the risk, we're not going to have the fulfilled faith of a miracle. Miracle is not going to happen unless we take that risk. Master of the banquet tasted the water that had been turned into wine. He did not realize what it had come from, but the servants who had drawn the water knew. So here is an interesting closing of the episode. So who knew about this great miracle happened in his wedding place? Who knew? So Jesus' mother Mary knew. Jesus' disciples knew because they were with Jesus. They heard Jesus. They saw what Jesus was doing. And the only other group of people who knew this miracle took place in this wedding setting was the servants. Not the guests, not even the master of the banquet, not even the bride and groom, but only the mother of Jesus, the disciples of Jesus, and the servants who actually took the action of obedience. Only they knew that the water was turning to wine, and they were the witnesses of the miracle. They had the blessing. Obedience brings blessing. We all want to be blessed. We want to have a happy, successful, wonderful life in this world. The Bible is telling us the secret of blessing. Obedience. Obedience. As we obey, the blessing of miracle will be given to us. The first of his miraculous signs Jesus performed in Cana of Galilee, he thus revealed his glory. His disciples put their faith in him. So we talked about in the beginning the definition of obedience. Do whatever God tells us. Whatever God tells us. That is the meaning of obedience. What will be the conclusion or purpose even of obedience? It is all about faith. See, the 12 disciples decide to follow Jesus, but they weren't 100% sure just yet. They heard the teachings of Jesus and they thought, okay, here is a great teacher. He talks about great philosophy of religion. We should follow him. Many people responded to Jesus' calling upon that kind of thought. He's a great teacher. They didn't know that Jesus was the Son of God. They didn't know that Jesus was the Messiah and Christ just yet. But this great happening of the miracle, as they eyewitnessed water turning into wine before their eyes, now they were able to believe, put their faith in Jesus. And this will be the reason or purpose of obedience and miracle of faith. God will perform miracles in our lives. When you are facing the end block in your life, something about your health, something about some monetary, financial situation, something about your relationship with some other people, if you feel like you are at the end of your life's tunnel, there's no way to turn to, that's when you need the miracle. And God will perform it for you as long as you believe in Jesus' power in your faith. It's all about faith. Jesus performed this miracle of turning water into wine so the disciples and servants could believe. Now, let me tell you the ultimate conclusion of this miracle episode. It's all about water. It's all about wine. Water is the Word of God. And the Bible says, Word of God became flesh in Jesus Christ. It's all about water, who is the Word, Logos, and it's all about Jesus. And wine, of course, we know what it symbolizes. Wine is the blood of Jesus Christ on the cross. So this is it, the secret formula of miracle of faith. We believe in the blood of Jesus Christ that was shed on the cross. We know Jesus is our Lord because the Bible says so. That water, that word. And as long as we believe in that and obey 100% to the brim, miracle will happen in our lives. We're going to take a moment to pray and meditate and see if you need any miracles in your life. Maybe not just yet, and that's good. But let me assure you, along the way in your life's journey, there will be time and situation where you will need a miracle. And God is willing to perform the miracle for you as long as you have that faith in the water, in the wine. Jesus being the Word of God and wine being the blood of Jesus Christ. We believe in the Bible. We believe in the holy blood of Jesus Christ and miracle of salvation. The miracle of faith will happen in our lives. Are we ready for that miracle? Let us take a moment to pray. Father God, we confess that we need miracles in our lives because we are limited in our power. We are finite in our wisdom. We know there will be some situations that no matter how hard we try, there is no way to escape except through the power of Jesus Christ. We need miracles in our lives. And we thank you for teaching us the secret, the formula of faith of miracle. It's all about the Word of God. It's all about the blood of Jesus Christ. As we believe and do what we're supposed to do, as the Bible tells us, miracle will happen in our lives. Father, help us to have that faith of miracle. And help us to live our Christian journey day by day, pleasing your holiness, and have our grace and blessings that is to be shared with our friends and neighbors. We thank you for your message and grace. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.